Good afternoon, and welcome to our weekly Bible study. I trust that you're enjoying, we're enjoying beautiful weather here in Southwest Missouri, nice and cool. Of course, it's August, and so we know that won't last, but we're enjoying the days when we have them. Well, we're going to continue our journey as we look at the power of the gospel through music. And as it's starting a couple of weeks ago, we started looking at what was the church reaction in the 60s with all the cultural changes that were taking place. And so I thought we'd do a quick overview here. We basically said that fell into four streams. Now there actually would be a fifth stream if I included just the traditional hymns that were sung in most churches at that time. But for the sake of this discussion, I've limited it to what was happening outside the church for the most part. And so in the Black Gospel, you had people like Mahalia Jackson or Doris Akers, and we had a chance to listen to them sing some great songs. Tommy Dorsey, that this would be the dad of the famous band leader, Tommy Dorsey. Then on the Southern Gospel side, that kind of fell into three categories. It was those like the Blackwood Brothers, and there were many groups that I could have put there, that I call them the diehards. They basically said, this is who we are. This is our tradition. We've been singing this way from the 30s, 40s, when many of the groups were started, into the 60s, 70s, and beyond. Now, what we find is what really changed was not so much the style of the music, but the instrumentation that accompanied the music got obviously more sophisticated through the decades. And then there were groups like the Oak Ridge Boys that basically just for a while season abandoned their roots. They were in Southern Gospel, and then they went into country. And it's interesting now, many years later, if you watch many of the Gaither Homecoming, you find the Oak Ridge Boys are now part of that, and they're going back and they'll sing the hymns. They're still doing it in a country style, but they're kind of going back to their roots a little bit. And then we talked about those that were changing their style, that really wanted to try to reach maybe the younger audience or newer audience. And so we spent some time looking at the Imperials as they try to transition, try to find their identity. The problem the Imperials ran into, for many years there, they lost their base. Their base was Southern Gospel. They changed the style and they alienated a lot. Now, the younger people like myself that was growing up, we liked that change, but we weren't buying the records and we weren't buying the tickets and, you know, we weren't going to the concerts like our parents were there. So they really struggled. Back then in the 70s, the Imperials kind of found their feet, their footing a little bit as they made that change. And then we looked at Mylon Lefebvre, who again was raised in Southern Gospel, goes through a period where he changes. Then last week, we looked at the third category. I call it the compromise column, or what became known as contemporary. The Imperials, by the time we get to the end of the 60s and the early 70s, they had made that transition. And so they definitely would fit in the contemporary column. We've spent some time looking at Ralph Carmichael, who tried to create music. He wrote some incredible songs in the late 50s that were sung by George Beverly Shea and others. But he tried to find a newer, more contemporary sound without alienating people in the church. It didn't mean he was always successful, as we talked about. Sometimes people weren't real happy with what he was doing. But the Billy Graham Association, I think, had a lot to do with helping him find his voice to a new audience, to the younger generation, because they were putting out these movies that were geared towards the younger generation, but also didn't alienate church people as much. But they would do it with this newer sound that Ralph Carmichael was creating. Then you had people, I haven't played any of your music, but during this period, you had people like Evie Turnquist, who became very famous. Now, she eventually got married and she became invisible because her husband was a minister in Norway. And so she went back to her home country because her family was from Norway. And so we kind of lost sight of her. She's made some visits on Gaither Homecoming and others from time to time. But Evie was huge, particularly in the early 70s. And then, of course, we looked at Andre Crouch, who started in the 60s. Andre was the first artist that Ralph Carmichael signed to a new recording place under Word. It was called Light Records. So he's a new one. Now we're going to start looking at the fourth column and the Jesus music. So there's some names that you may be familiar with. You may not know many of these names at all. Larry Norman was probably the first. He releases a project, I think it was in 67 or 68, and it's officially the first Jesus people music. Mylon Lefebvre released something in 68, 69. The problem with Mylon was that because he came out of the Southern gospel, he was trying to appeal to people in the South, and people in the South were not listening to Jesus music. It was basically on the coast, primarily on the West Coast, but also on the East Coast. And so Mylon got really kind of lost in the shuffle, even though he was one of the early ones who transitioned to this newer sound. Now, there's two things I want to say about this new sound. Not only was it different in terms of the music, by today's standard, it was pretty tame, but what's more radical about it was that the lyrics were much more focused about the issues of the day. You know, if you were listen to pop culture and listen to even the rock and roll, you got all kinds of, you know, 10 different varieties of singing a love song or something like that. But when you started getting into the Jesus music and in the late 60s, things became more political, started speaking to the issues of its day. Well, that happened in church music as well, the Jesus music. They started writing lyrics that were speaking to the issues of the day. And a lot of people were uncomfortable with that combination of kind of a different content along with this different style. There were other people like Randy Stonehill. He was a real trip. He was a character, but he was part of this. Keith Green, it came a little bit later in the 70s. Nancy Honeytree, we're actually going to listen to one of her songs today. She was called the First Lady of Jesus music. And then by the time we get to the 70s, we start seeing bands like Petra. So these would be some of the people that would be in this genre of music. So let's go back to the beginnings. When did the Jesus people movement, or the Jesus music, all these terms when did it start? Well, they trace it back to 1967, which was the Summer of Love. The Summer of Love arises in the midst of a cultural environment where young people are rebelling against the establishment. San Francisco became the focal point of what was happening here. It was this destination where teens, literally thousands and thousands of teens, just invaded San Francisco in the summer of 1967, okay? Thinking that we're countercultural. Anything their parents stood for, I'm for something else. You know, I'm not sure what they stood for, but they definitely knew what they didn't like. So tens of thousands, what we will later call hippies, descended on San Francisco's Haight-Ashbury district to celebrate personal expression, drug experimentation, LSD, easy sex. Now, the song that captures the essence of what was happening in 1967 was a song called "Are You Going to San Francisco?" And so it became the big hit. So as my gets ready here, let's listen to Scott McKenzie.
If you're going to San Francisco, I'm sorry.
So far out, man. That was groovy. Okay. You might remember some of those terms that were used back during that period. So it was in this atmosphere that the Jesus People Movement was born. It was the summer of love. So what happened? The rise of the hippie movement resulted from rejection of conformity. We talked about that already. They were searching for and creating a countercultural way of life that was contrary to what they saw in their parents. See, they found their parents' life to be predictable, boring, traditional. So they were just looking for something different. However, it didn't take very long to realize, if you look at that third bullet, that in the midst of the summer of love, there were a number of problems that began to surface real fast. Doesn't look a whole lot different than it does today. There was overcrowding, leading to homelessness, crime, sexual transmitted diseases was rampant, bad drug trips, overdoses. Every night, thousands of penniless young people who were out there to have this great experience all of a sudden didn't bring money with them. Maybe their mom and dad cut them off because they had left them who knows what. And they would crash and they would sleep in the streets. Okay. Now, while these young people were initially disillusioned with their parents' way of life, their counterculture began to start showing it didn't have the answers either. And that was the sad reality. Because when you lose the basis of your foundation and you go to something else and it doesn't work, but you rejected the foundation that you grew up on, what do you have? And it really left a lot of this generation really floundering. You know, I mean, they had sought sexual freedom. They were barefoot, bell bottoms. Substance abuse was rampant, but they weren't living healthier lives. It had a momentary zing to it, but the zing wore out and they began to struggle. And on top of that, there were things happening like Bobby Kennedy and Dr. King being assassinated. You had cults like Jonestown springing up. You had the civil rights movement still continuing to go, anti-war. You just had a lot of churn in the culture going on. And the thing they sought for really wasn't providing the answers that they thought it would, because they didn't have a solution. All they had was, we're not happy with what was there. Okay. So as they became disillusioned, a new evangelist appeared in the San Francisco area. This evangelist was long-haired and had beards. Okay. They were urging people to follow Jesus Christ, to forsake drugs and promiscuous sex. It was because of their dress that helped them bridge the gap. It was an opportunity to share the gospel. They didn't have the people come to them. They went to the hippies themselves. They went out in the streets and they would go and, you know, in the little, you know, song we just watched there, you were seeing all kinds of little groups gathering. And so these hippie evangelists would just sit down with them and just start having a dialogue and talking about life. And then they would ask the question, have you ever considered Jesus Christ? Have you ever considered what Christ could do? And there was a receptivity that was there because, again, there was a disillusionment that was not satisfied, at least in a longing, lasting way. And so these, we'll call them Jesus people or Jesus freaks, they, through their dress and everything else, they either came out of that culture or they were able to identify with that culture, and they began to share the gospel with this group. Key to this new presence on the streets was a man by the name of Ted Weiss. He was a drug user who had gotten saved in 1965 after one of his numerous LSD trips. His wife joined him and several other hippie couples in going into the streets of San Francisco. The unconventional ways of these new believers antagonized many in the local church. So they didn't have a wide support from the local churches, but they began to see fruit, a revival emerged. It was a counterculture to the counterculture. So we got all kinds of countercultures going on that began to draw these kids, because they weren't asking them to go back to what they had left if they had grown up in the church. They were asking them to consider something else that was out here. And because it was new, remember, this is the mindset of that generation. If it's new, maybe I ought to consider it. And so they considered the claims of Jesus Christ. Now, it's interesting that word Jesus freak, or phrase Jesus freak, was a derogatory term, much like Christian was in the city of Antioch back in the first century. But as typically happens, these Jesus hippies took on and says, "Hey, I'm a Jesus freak." Yeah, and they were proud. That was their banner. Because again, they were promoting something that was non-traditional. It became a badge of honor. By 1971, now this is interesting. In the early 60s, Time has a magazine, God is Dead. By 1971, the Jesus people are the front page story of Time magazine. So within a decade, you see a massive change that was happening. And it wasn't happening among the older generation. It was happening among the younger generation. Now, several pastors begin to say, well, listen, maybe we can help these hippie evangelists. And so they begin to establish a new venue for bringing these people together, because a pastor's heart is he's concerned not only that people come to know Jesus Christ, but that they grow in their walk with God. We call that discipleship. And so Ted Weiss didn't have any vehicle to disciple these brand new people that had just gotten saved, because many of them were still probably tripping out. They now said, I believe in Jesus, but they were still working with a lot of baggage that's taking place there. So they built their first coffee house a block north of the intersection of Haight and Ashbury. They founded this coffee house. It became the new church building for these hippies that were getting saved on the streets to go to. And there would be people there would sit there and talk about what does it mean to be a follower of Jesus Christ, and begin to take them through those basic things that you and I take for granted, especially if we've grown up in the church. Now, central to this new movement that's taking place, now this is moving fast. We're talking in a matter of months to a year, this is beginning to grow. What was central to this was a devotion and zeal for reaching the generation. That was their heart. They felt like this was a lost generation and that they need to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. And these evangelists would declare that it was only Jesus that could fill the longings that they were searching for. Remember, we played a song from the Imperials that it's a new world. You know, everything's changed, but until you try Jesus, really your world's never changed. It's not different. And this is what the evangelists were saying. Hey, listen, you really want a new world? You want to change your world? You got to realize that Jesus Christ died for you. God cares about you. So their method of evangelism was working the streets with a guitar and a Bible. And then they started forming these little bands that would travel across the country to share the good news. And the movement, again, had these two major components. The Bible was a place for one's answers, and they had this new music. Music was central to what was happening. So even in their defining slogan, the raised finger and the words "one way," which we see athletes do all the time, you know, after they score a touchdown, you know, it's one way. Where did that come from? It came from this movement in the 60s, was acknowledgement that in the midst of pain and chaos and uncertainty, it was only in Jesus Christ could they find peace and joy. And as I said before, the focus of this evangelism was, hey, you want to hear about Jesus? Come to my church. No. They went to where the people were at, which is exactly what Jesus said. As you are going, share the good news. We have this idea that we invite in the church and then get saved. That's not exactly how Jesus presented the gospel. It's that we are to go on the highways and hedges. We're to go. We're to share the good news. And they took that literally when they did this and says, listen, they're not going to step inside my church, but I can go into their world. And again, because of their dress and whatever, they were able to connect. So these coffee houses began to flourish. So the first one was started in San Francisco. And one of the key features about these coffee houses was come as you are. Now, I got to pause here and tell you a story. When I was in Springfield, in the mid-70s, graduating from seminary. And pastor was from New Jersey here, looking for a youth pastor. And my professor said, Duane, you need to go spend some time with this pastor. I think you would be a good fit. I had no interest in leaving Springfield, Missouri. I had a staff position at the time. And so I thought, it's good practice, you know, see, someday I may want to interview. So we'll practice. So I took Judy because we were married at the time. And we sat there. And this guy told us this fascinating story. And the story went like this. He says, I'm from Elizabeth, New Jersey. Now, if you know anything about northern New Jersey, Elizabeth is not the hopping center of the world today. It was. It's right across the river from New York City. It's right next to Newark. And he said, I pastor a church there. The church has been there for a long time. And a few years ago, we started a coffee house. Starts telling me about this coffee house. And we brought in a group, a singing group from the West Coast that had long hair and beards to sing in this coffee house. And they stayed for months. And we had hundreds of kids get saved in this coffee house. One of those singers became the youth pastor for about a year and a half. And so he's connecting with all these street kids. Problem was, the church was growing and he had a bunch of church kids. And though he wasn't connecting very well. And the pastor was beginning to say, at what point do the hippies, the Jesus people, start connecting and we connecting with them and them connecting with us? So he was looking for this magic solution of how to integrate two very different cultures into the church, because they had just shut down the coffee house. And so all those kids had started coming to the church. It was a trip when Judy and I went out there. It was an experience. We actually went on staff for 2 years. It was the most incredible experience you ever wanted to. But what made that church connect in the community was the coffee house. That was, so it became the place. And many of those hippies that got saved, even into the 70s, they would actually go to church there because they would have Bible studies several times a week. They'd have their own church services with the idea that at some point, maybe there would be assimilation into more of a traditional church setting. But for years, that was their church. That's where they connected. That's where they had this community support and everything else that took place. And the motto was, come as you are, fleas, smell sometimes. And it was interesting because by the time we get to the very late 60s and early 70s, churches are trying to figure out, how do we help these new Christians grow in Christ? And here was the struggle. Some churches said, well, once they take a bath and start wearing decent clothes, then they can come to our church, which basically was saying, you got to look like a Christian before we'll let you in. And then there were some other churches that were kind of weird churches. We were one of them in New Jersey that said, you come as you are. We'll let the Holy Spirit speak to your heart. And over time, they will be changed. And by the way, they did change because I had a chance. They were in my ministry leadership team. Many of them were incredible and able to connect with the younger generation because the younger generation couldn't put anything over. These guys had been and gals had been through everything. They had seen everything and they could speak their language. So there were churches that began to make adjustments, started in the West Coast, where typically a lot of things start. Okay. And it was, we were called hipster churches. Okay. Kind of sounds familiar. That's what they were referred to back then because of the hippies. They were hipster churches because they were much more open. They allowed these the music to come in, and they allowed obviously the dress to come in, and they began to flood these churches. So these Jesus people evangelists were adopting the clothing and the language. Now, to say that this is the first time is an untrue statement. Hudson Taylor did the exact same thing in the 1800s when he went to China, because he was a British missionary, and all the missionaries, the British missionaries were along the coast And he says, there are millions of people who need to hear about the gospel. And he says, and when they see me coming, they see British, and they won't listen to me. So what he did is he changed his garment. He dressed Chinese and he began to wear his hair long into a ponytail. And if you see some of Hudson Taylor, in fact, this is his ministry team. These are all of his missionaries that he got from Britain to come and help him. And you can see they're all in Chinese garb because that was his trait. He says, I want to remove one unnecessary barrier to people hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now, do you like those bell bottoms? Those are good. Those are good. I imagine a few of you had a pair like that. Who's the picture of this guy here? This was the guy who was one of those hippie evangelists that's talked about in the movie that's out, the Jesus Revolution, who is associated with Chuck Smith. And we'll come to that in just a moment. So here we have across the country now, in a matter of just a few short years, coffee houses springing up, okay? They were the meeting place for the youth to hear local or traveling Jesus music bands, okay? I mean, they weren't renting out the big venues. These were intimate, maybe 50, 100 people would be there. I remember going to one of these. It was actually at one of the high school, and there were 100 kids that were there listening to Phil Keaggy play. Oh my goodness. And I'm thinking, where is everyone? They didn't care. It wasn't about the money. There was such an innocence in the early days of the Jesus movement. They were just there to love Jesus and love each other. They had no desire to go mainstream, none whatsoever. Now that's going to change when we get into the 70s, but in the late 60s, no interest to go mainstream. The music being played in the coffee house was not tradition at all. Okay. In fact, many in the mainstream churches said that's the devil's music. And the Jesus People movement said, why does the devil have all the good music? And we're going to listen to a little song that was written by Larry Norman about this very thing, because they weren't afraid of music. They weren't afraid of rock and roll. Now, it's pretty tame by today's standards. Some of it's more pop, some of it's even more focused. That was coming out, but there were some that were beginning to get a little more heavy duty. The style didn't matter to them. It was about, I need to connect with my audience, and I'm going to use the music and the tools that I have to reach them. Eventually, this music is going to be called the Jesus music. And I've got a picture here of just a group. There could be one of those Jesus people, evangelists, in the midst of them talking, and they would just come because they had nothing else to do. They didn't have jobs. Okay? They were just out enjoying whatever they wanted to in San Francisco. So we're going to read the lyrics first, and then we're going to listen to Larry Norman, who is the first what we would call Jesus People music artist. I want the people to know that he saved my soul, but I still like to listen to the radio. They say rock and roll is wrong. Well, give you one more chance. I say, I feel so good, I got to get up and dance. I know what's right. I know what's wrong. I don't confuse it. All I'm really trying to say is, why should the devil have all the good music? I feel good every day because Jesus is the rock and he rolled my sins away. They say to cut my hair. They're driving me insane. I grew it out long to make room for my brain. But sometimes people don't understand what's a good boy doing in a rock and roll band. There's nothing wrong with playing blues licks. But if you got a reason to tell me to my face, why should the devil have all the good music? There's nothing wrong with what I play because Jesus is the rock and he rolled my blues away. I ain't knocking the hymns. Just give me a song that has a beat. I ain't knocking the hymns. Just give me a song that moves my feet. I don't like none of those funeral march songs. I ain't dead yet. Now, you can see that the church didn't welcome him with open arms. Because, man, he's slamming everything there. But guess what? The Jesus people, hippies, loved him. Loved him. So we're not going to play the whole song because I don't know if you can stomach it. Although it's not that hard. It's an interesting tune. But let me get started here. Why should the devil have all the good music?
I want the people to know that he saved my soul, but I still like to listen to the radio. They say rock and roll is wrong, we'll give you one more chance. I say I feel so good, I gotta get up and dance. I know what's right, I know what's wrong, I don't confuse it. All I'm really trying to say is why should the devil have all the good music? And I feel good every day, because Jesus is the rock and he rolled my blues away. They say to cut my hair, they're driving me insane. I blew it out long to make room for my brain. But sometimes people don't understand what's a good boy doing in a rock and roll band. There's nothing wrong with playing blues lick, but if you got a reason, tell me to my face, why should the devil have all the good music? There's nothing wrong with what I play. Oh, Jesus is a rock and roll, my blues away. All right. Song that has a beat. I ain't knocking the hymns, just give me a song that moves my feet. I don't like none of those funeral marches. I ain't dead yet.
All right. So almost sounded like, who does that sound like? Yeah, Jerry Lee Lewis, exactly. Exactly. Interesting how the different genres impact each other. So let's transition, because it really came established when it moved to LA. This movement started in San Francisco. And so the Jesus People movement spread to Southern California. And so it began to attract not only hardcore hippies from the drug culture in the streets, but also teens who were really satisfied, kind of like the Milo Lefevers would fit in this category. All of a sudden they saw, hey, I can identify with that. You know, yes, I grew up this way, but I really don't like that anymore. So churches who were effective in reaching the youth of this period adjusted their forms. And the most obvious of this was Calvary Chapel in Costa Mesa. Pastor Chuck Smith was a four-square Pentecostal preacher, and he had the small church, and he welcomed them. Fundamental to his philosophy of ministry was teaching through the whole counsel of God. He preached from Genesis to Revelation every 7 years, kind of like Gordon Burnham McGee, if you on a Moody radio, do the same thing. He would actually preach through, but he did it. I've actually listened to many of his tapes, and it was so good. It wasn't deep, but it was very helpful in tying things together. And so teaching the scripture was very important to Chuck Smith, but he was open to their music. So when he started walking the church grew, was running about 150. Within a matter of months, it's running thousands. Okay. They grew so much they had to meet in a tent until they could grow. And then every month they would baptize 500 people in Pirates Cove in the Pacific. There were people getting saved. That's how many people were getting saved over a couple year period. Now, what was interesting about Chuck Smith is it had low liturgy. In other words, it wasn't really a structured, it had structure, but not like some of the churches where you have a program and everything else there. There was a little bit more free flowing, especially their evening services. And they were open to contemporary music. The story is told where the elders of Calvary Chapel put up a no bare feet allowed in the church. They had just installed some new carpet and they didn't want their carpet ruined. So Chuck Smith got the board together and says, if we turn away one person because of they have bare feet or dirty clothes, I'm ripping up the carpet and the pews. He says, we are not going to go down that path. And we can applaud him. So here's a picture on the right. Here's a picture of Chuck Smith. This is the picture of the tent. It was a big tent. It could handle hundreds of people. And this is where they met for many years. I don't know if this is Love Song. It was one of the early groups that came out of Calvary Chapel. Yeah, it took place there. Okay. This is a photo of the ocean baptism. This is Pirate's Cove. And you can see people would come in under the hills, and they would sit there and they would watch, and people would be baptized. They would have half a dozen people baptizing at once. And when they would come up, they would do following Jesus, the one way sign. I want to show you the people here at Township have seen this, but maybe you haven't. But Michael W. Smith took a chorus that came out of the Jesus movement. They will know we are Christians by our love. It was kind of one of the theme songs in the late 60s and moved into the 70s. And he took that lyric. Obviously, he's added some instrumentation to it. But the videos that you're going to watch are from the movie, The Jesus Revolution. And you're going to see some of the environment that Chuck Smith and the Jesus movement was taking place. So enjoy Michael W. Smith. They will know we're Christians.
We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. We are
stop there and just get out of here because I want to just wrap this up. Several things I want to comment on. Number one, there was such an innocence. It was kind of like people were going back and finding a new foundation. They had rejected their parents. They rejected the establishment that's taking place. And you listen to it. This is such a simple little chorus, but that was characteristic of the late 60s. It was almost like they were going back and starting all over again with these little simple choruses. Second thing I want to share is one of the reasons why that song became such a trademark song for the Jesus movement because it captured the essence. I remember when I went to go on staff in that church in New Jersey, and I remember talking with parents, and they said to me, I saw my kids go off the deep end. I saw my kids basically destroying their life in drugs. And then all of a sudden, they came home and told us that they had met a new friend called Jesus. And we just thought they were just on another trip. But we watched them change. Because all of a sudden, there was a love that they had, not only for their new friend Jesus, but all of a sudden, they had a love for us they never had before. They had a love for each other. And I'm always reminded of that when I read in John where Jesus' words are, they'll know you are Christians, not by your doctrine, even though that's important, not by what you say, but what you do. Do you show? Do you demonstrate love? Now, there was lots of junk that went on during this period. Not everyone got their acts together. But I can tell you this because I worked with them shoulder to shoulder, that there were people that literally were transformed. If you met them today, you would have thought they grew up in the church and had never gone off the deep end. And they've got stories that would just shake you to the core if you knew their stories. What changed them was the love of Jesus and someone who was willing to share the message in a way that got their attention. Maybe it was through a song that was a little different than what they had heard before, or maybe it was a person who looked a little different from them, but they were able to connect. And what was more important, it wasn't about the long hair and the beard. It was about the Jesus that they were talking about. As we wrap this up today, may we be people who not only talk about love, but when we show love with each other. God bless you. Have a great, great day. May the peace of God be with you. Amen. Amen.